Hawaii's kupuna are an important part of the fabric of our state, and their contributions, both past and in the future, play a vital role in Hawaii's success. Good evening, and thank you for joining us for Ike Kupuna, where we honor those who have made a big difference in the world of sports, entertainment, and the fight for justice. We begin with a political powerhouse couple and a story that's more love than government. It's been years since former Hawaii Governor Jean Ariyoshi and his wife, former First Lady Jean Ariyoshi, lived here at Washington Place. But they remember it vividly and still think about what's best for local residents. The year was 1952. Jean Hayashi was a sophomore at the University of Hawaii and was invited to a party, the same one 26-year-old Jean Ariyoshi was at.
But I passed through the kitchen, and there was this very tall, good-looking six-footer who had these bushy black eyebrows, and eyebrows that when he talked went up and down, and it was kind of sexy, you know, at that time.
She was about to leave the party, but then...
We started talking, and the chemistry started, and he said, well, can I steal a dance before you leave? So I said, oh, okay. So we went to the dance floor, and I said, I was really worried because I thought, well, this guy is a little older than me. He was already a lawyer. I was only 19. And I said, oh, I don't think this guy knows how to jitterbug. And so as we approached the floor, we danced, and he was, wow, he really surprised me. He was a great jitterbugger. You really were. He was a great dancer.
He called her the next day, and the two have been together ever since. They married in 1955 when she was a college senior and he was running in his first of numerous political races.
I committed my life to being a legislator, and I married this girl. And you know, during the election, she couldn't vote for me in the primary election because she was not old enough.
Ariyoshi won that election and everyone that followed, serving in the House and Senate. He later became Hawaii's Lieutenant Governor and Governor. He was the country's first Asian American governor, the state's longest serving governor, and at the age of 97, Hawaii's oldest living former governor.
But I told my people, one, no tax increase. I don't want anybody to get taxed. Secondly, I told them, nobody gets laid off. And thirdly, I said, nobody gets cut in pay. And they all told me, how are you going to do it? I said, I can't do it. You got to help me.
The former First Lady said she left the government up to her husband while she ran Washington Place.
And that was my biggest thing about being First Lady, is what I could do to make the home a home of all of the people of Hawaii that could be proud of, because it was such a historical home and there was a lot of spirit in that home when we lived there.
Another goal that Mrs. Ariyoshi set and achieved was planting 1 million trees in the state.
What are some of the best memories of when you were in office?
They were really a golden part of our life. I mean, when I think about my experiences that I was able to go through.
It's been over 35 years since he served as Hawaii's governor, but Jean Ariyoshi still spends much of his time thinking about what's best for our state. He even wrote a book during the pandemic about Hawaii's future.
People think they can do it themselves. When you become a leader, that's what they think. Oh, I'm a leader, and I know how to lead. I can do it myself. But if that's all it is, then you have a mass, great, great mass of people who are working for you. And they also must know that they are needed. I spent a lot of time talking to employees.
What's your message to the next generation?
For one thing, don't be selfish and consider what you can do to help the people in the community. You gotta have that feeling, help the people in the community, otherwise you can't do very much.
When I think of the future, I think of the younger generation, and I think that with the younger generation, they should learn more, keep on learning, because what they learn today might not be enough for tomorrow.
The Ariyoshis are enjoying life with their grandchildren and great-grandchildren. Mrs. Ariyoshi also organizes a women's Japanese tea group. And they are still in love, still looking out for each other. So what's the secret to your long marriage?
Well, listen to what she wants to listen to her. But she has been a very good wife. She takes care of me. She gets me fed. And especially now, I don't get to the office of mail. So she makes telephone calls for me, and she does everything for me. So I'm very lucky.
Mrs. Ariyoshi, who is now 88 years old, says part of loving is giving back. In fact, she says her husband still offers to massage her when she feels aches and pains.
One gives more than the other, depending on the emotional, depending on the experiences, depending on the problems. Some have it more, one have the other more than the other. So it's a matter of adjusting to this.
And 70 years later, the chemistry is still there.
His eyebrows have gone white, but they're still loving.
When we come back, a living legend and local diva.
Face of an angel, pretty eyes that shine.
Melveen Leed shares her biggest struggles and accomplishments. Whether it's on stage for a crowd of thousands, or sitting at her piano at home, Melveen Leed knows how to entertain.
Enough already.
Oh, I get chicken skin.
The 80-year-old singer and actress from Molokai has been wowing crowds since she was 15 years old, performing in Waikiki and in the military clubs.
And they were known as the exotics, and so they used to have gigs there. And so they paid me $15, and I was 15 years old.
Her unique vocals and local style all come naturally. No vocal lessons needed.
One day, Patty Page I met her and I said, oh, you know, I'm gonna take opera lessons tomorrow, vocal lessons. She went, oh honey, don't do that. I said, why? She says, no, you have a beautiful style of your own. So I canceled my vocal lesson, and I didn't take any lessons at all.
Leed says she learned by ear and watching other entertainers like Don Ho and Marlene Tsai.
And I loved the way she sang, and she sang from her heart, you know, so that's how I learned.
The accolades have followed Leed throughout her career with numerous albums, several years as part of the local diva singing group, 5 Nahoku Hanohano Awards for Best Female Vocalist, performances across the world, and perhaps most importantly to her, giving back as a teacher.
And there are different levels of singing and vocals. It's teaching the knowledge that I have that I learned by myself, you know? And that's the high for me, yeah. Knowing that I have this gift from God, yeah.
A gift that was sharpened throughout her youth growing up on Molokai, Maui, and Oahu, and spending time with her grandparents who helped raise her.
His teachings. I know how to make fish nets. I know how to throw nets. I know how to fish. I know how to hunt. I know how to garden. I know how to, and my grandmother, of course.
It was during her teenage years when she first met Mike Reyes.
She used to be on the porch every afternoon, singing and playing the uke. Amazing.
A longtime family friend and neighbor, they reconnected after nearly 50 years and have now been married for over a decade.
He doesn't care if I'm Melveen Leed or not. He treats me like a human being, like someone that he loves and treasures and puts me on a pedestal above everything else. I've never seen any man do that to me before.
Mike was by her side through her battle with leukemia in 2018.
He was right by my side all the way. He said, don't worry, I'm here. That's all he had to say, and I love you.
She's now in remission, enjoying her time with her husband, daughter, and 2 grandchildren.
continuing to teach, continuing to win over fans of all ages with weekly concerts on Facebook.
Like when I do a reggae song, the younger kids go like, wow, wow, auntie, you know? And they pump their necks, yeah? And so I said, well, do you think we cannot? You know, we can, of course. Yeah.
And continuing to live by her motto,
do what you love and love what you do. Because if it's from the heart, it reaches the heart.
Whenever you come.
When Ike Kupuna continues, she's dedicated her life to helping some of Hawaii's most vulnerable. And later, a trip back in time when the UH baseball team didn't even have a practice field until this man came along. For 40 years, Nancy Creedman spent her days advocating for victims of domestic violence, pushing for changes in policy, and raising awareness for our community. But these days, you're more likely to find her here.
I'm a big swimmer, and I'm sure now that I came here because of the water.
Creedman is officially retired and ready to start a new chapter in her life.
It has been an incredibly challenging and fulfilling journey for me. But I spend all my time worrying and rushing. So I'm gonna eliminate the worrying and the rushing as much as I can. I'm gonna have to teach myself. I'm gonna have to dial that back.
Her journey of service began in the 1970s, working at a domestic violence shelter in New York, just as awareness about the issue was starting to take shape.
So when I got here, I thought, huh, I wonder what we're doing here to address the problem of domestic violence. And of course, we weren't doing anything.
Creedman moved to Hawaii without ever having set foot in the islands, but was drawn here by the outdoors. She started volunteering at the only domestic violence shelter and realized quickly that people here didn't relate to the messaging about violence.
And I would take with me the only film that the shelter owned, and it was a film with all white people, one black person and one Hispanic person. And when I would turn the film on, I recognized that the people in my audience couldn't figure out how does that relate to us, who are those people. And I teamed up with a director and we produced the first documentary about domestic violence in Hawaii. It's called Too Many Lickens, Spouse Abuse in Hawaii.
Spending time in the shelter with victims also made Creedman realize there was so much more to be done.
So they'd spend the day looking at possible new homes, come home at the end of the day, come back to the shelter at the end of the day, and start packing up to return home. The places they'd seen were too expensive, too far from their kids' schools, impossible to manage. Made me very anxious, and I thought, their partners did not change over the weekend, so they're going to go back to the same situation that they escaped from.
The Domestic Violence Action Center was formed in 1990, a place for legal help, support, and advocacy for victims and families.
People deserve to live free and safe. No one deserves to be harmed by their partner.
Creedman is a parent herself, mother to three kids, soon to be grandmother to five grandkids, and a wife to her partner Bernard of 40 years. She says she will refocus her attention in retirement from other families to her own.
I really couldn't have done this without my family's blessings, my husband's willingness, my children's forgiveness. I'm hoping I can make some of that up to them.
But she knows there's still work to be done to stop domestic violence in our community.
In fact, there's a part of me that feels like there is still so much suffering. I wish I could have done more.
Creedman's legacy and dedication to the cause will remain even as she explores new paths.
So I see myself with a lot of open space. I'll spend maybe more time with my family, with my grandchildren, in the ocean, in the jungle, read more, maybe nap a little bit, travel a little bit. It's a whole wide world out there.
When Ike Kupuna returns, you'll meet the man responsible for all of this. The legendary Les Murakami shares his fondest memories and his hopes for the future of UH baseball. His name is synonymous with the University of Hawaii baseball program. For 30 years, Les Murakami served as head coach, taking a team that didn't have a practice field to the College World Series. Although he's retired, he still vividly remembers every challenge and every celebration and continues to cheer on the boys on the diamond. For three decades, he was there at every University of Hawaii baseball game. The same stance, the same look, the same passion for the sport.
There's no end until it ends, you know. You don't, it's not like there's time limit. There's no time limit.
Former UH baseball coach Les Murakami built a legendary legacy, winning nearly 1,100 games, taking the team to 10 NCAA regionals and winning 6 conference titles. The UH baseball stadium is also named after him. He retired more than 20 years ago after suffering a stroke.
I wish I was better, but I'm okay.
He still vividly remembers his time there and the days leading up to it. That includes the conversations he had with former UH athletic director Paul Durham, who asked him to lead the team in the early 1970s.
The first time, and I told him, no, you don't even have a park to play. I told him, how can I go over there yet?
At the time, Murakami was already coaching other local teams in the AJA and winning championships.
So I told him no. It's the first year, first time, the second time, no, I told him no. The third time, I told him no. And the fourth time, he came over, he told me, hey, you don't know what can happen. But I told him, well, I don't see anything happening. So he tells me, come on, give us a break, he told me. So I said, okay.
Murakami's father encouraged him as well.
And my father told me, hey, what you got to lose? He told me, you cannot win anything already. You win everything.
Murakami faced an uphill battle from the beginning of his UH career. The university didn't even have a baseball practice field, and the team wasn't competing against mainland colleges. But with the help of a friend who was a landscaper, he made a field where the UH softball field currently sits. He also received backing from lawmakers to secure money for a stadium.
So when I put even the new field, when I had it built, I put it to dimensions that made for me, not for them. You know, I had 400 in center, 340 down the line, right and left, and the power alleys, I had it about 380, you know. And everybody telling me, hey, how you guys gonna hit home run? I told them, you think I worry about my guys? My guy's not gonna hit home run anyway. It's all these big teams coming in. I wanna keep the ball in the field.
Murakami also credits a former player, his favorite, for bringing in the fan.
Well, it gotta be Derek Tatsuno. I called him the Pied Piper. Because until he came, I was drawing 100, 200, 300 people. And then the first year he came, sold out, standing room only.
The pitching sensation is also part of Murakami's best baseball moment, which still brings a smile to his face.
Well, there's no doubt, 1980 World Series. And you know something? Because I didn't win it, I came in second. I made up my mind that I wanted to get back. And that's why I coached so long, because I wanted to get back.
Also part of that historic team and journey, KHON2's Howard Deshevsky.
He couldn't hit the curveball. What? You know.
As you can see, at the age of 87, Murakami is still telling it like it is, even when remembering other athletes like former pro baseball player Barry Bonds.
Everybody was after him, you know. High school, he was the number one guy, except me. And the reason for that is I knew he was good. First thing I did is I checked his transcript. When I looked at the transcript, I laughed. I said, I cannot even get this guy in the back door. It was so terrible, yeah.
Murakami still stresses education to Keiki looking to make it to the big leagues.
I don't care what you do. Number one that you have to do, I said, you got to go to school. You know, the only thing I said, all of a sudden when you're a junior in high school and then you say, oh, I want to play for UH, too late. I mean, you got to study, you know, so you can make the grades or not. You're not going to be able to go to school, I told him.
And if you're wondering if he still watches UH baseball, the answer is yes, but most of the time supporting the team from home.
Well, I know that, like this new coach that's coaching now, the thing that I like about him, he uses the young kids, the local kids. And for me to build a stadium, I promised the legislature that if they got me the stadium, I'll promise you that I'll use local kids.
By Murakami's side, his wife, Dot. They've been married for almost 60 years. She supported him during those coaching years when he spent a lot of time on the road. Now he's able to spend more time with his family, which includes two kids and two grandkids. One of those grandkids is also stepping up to the plate in Manoa, his granddaughter who committed to UH to play softball. As for Murakami, he said he misses the camaraderie of the baseball team, but he's trying to take care of his health. He fought rectal cancer 4 years ago and now does daily exercises with the help of his aide and goes to physical therapy.
I always told those guys, especially if we're losing, I said, don't give up, don't give up. And I always tell them, I said, don't give up, no. And I know they're watching me and they want to know whether I'm going to give up.
He won't give up, as he's shown with every challenge he's faced. He'll be swinging for the fences for as long as he can. We thank the Kupuna who we honor tonight for the wisdom they share and for the lessons they continue to pass on to the next generation. Mahalo for watching, everyone. Aloha.